Thank you. So I just want to start out by saying welcome to Advent 2020. That kind of really says something really interesting, because it's 2020, and a lot of people have been saying that 2020 is the new bad word, but we're going to say that the first Sunday in Advent 2020 is about hope, and the good Lord knows that we need a whole lot of hope in 2020. Where the Advent season should be a time of spiritual reflection, joy, and anticipation, we're facing an Advent season when there is a darkness, and the world has been deeply divided. You have corrupt practices that are oppressive and isolating and debilitating and devastating, and we just don't know what it's going to look like, but we have a choice to make today. Today we seek the light, or we're going to be consumed by the darkness, because by seeking the light, it involves that preparing for Jesus appearing in all areas of our lives. So as Amen. We enter this Advent season, anyone who's spent any time in church knows that when you tell the story of the birth of Jesus Christ, there's only two books in the New Testament that you can go to. Either you're going to go to Matthew or you're going to go to Luke. For they're the only gospel writers that record the events surrounding the birth in Bethlehem. So there's a passage of scripture that I'm sure all of you are familiar with. It comes from the Gospel of Luke. So if you have your hard copies, your electronic copies, go with me to Luke chapter 2. I will be reading verses 1-7, and I will be reading them from the Newly Revised Standard Version. That's the NRSV version, and it reads, "In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinus was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn." Today, I'd like to talk a little bit about the message of the manger. And I want to start by saying I have a guilty pleasure. I love Madea movies, and I love watching them with my mother because she's 93. She has Alzheimer's, but Madea keeps her entertained. So we watched the Madea Christmas the other day.
Hey, man.
It's Christmas movie season. And one of the themes that they have are struggling with keeping Christ in Christmas. And as they struggled with it, I once again struggled with two issues that I do every time around this year. And I used to really struggle when it came to raising my son. As a parent who took the responsibility to train up my son in the way in which he should go, I first wanted to be certain that he was not consumed with commercialism, capitalism, and consumption. I needed him to know that you don't need 20 gifts under the tree to know that he was blessed. I didn't stress the idea of somebody coming down a chimney. He knew who gave him those gifts, and he knew who had been blessing him all year long. And you don't need everything on your list to be checked in order to know that you got a reason to be grateful. And of course, I'm not just talking about children. There's some grown folks that need to receive this message in this 2020 Advent first Sunday of hope. Because despite how stressful and disappointing and strange 2020 has been, God has been blessing us all year long. And we really don't need everything on our list to be checked to know that God is still good and still worthy to be praised. My second struggle was not only to keep him away from commercialism, capitalism, and consumption. I wanted to be certain that Christ remained the center of his celebration. I wanted to be certain that he knew why he celebrated and what we celebrated and who we celebrated. That may seem easy, but it's really difficult because Christmas is really one of those paradoxical holidays. It's one of the only few that comes with a mixed message. If you think about it, every other holiday we celebrate, we're clear about what we're celebrating. Veterans Day. We know we're celebrating those brave soldiers, those men and women who serve in our armed forces. 4th of July. We know it's about the independence of our nation. And there are folks who had better not get Valentine's Day mixed up and not celebrate their boo. But somehow, some way, Christmas has a funny way of becoming sterilized and politically correct. And it seems like Jesus gets edited and removed from a lot of the celebrations. I mean, growing up, I heard more about Santa, Rudolph, Frosty, and Scrooge than I did about Jesus Christ. It's amazing to think that 78% of Americans celebrate Christmas, but the majority of them do it in a way that is sanitized and sterilized and void and edited of the heralding of Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of this earth. Christmas starts with the birth of Jesus and takes us to a journey to the cross at Easter. So the question that must be asked is, how is it that Christ is so easily overlooked and omitted from the celebration of Christmas? So here's where I'm glad I finished seminary, because I want to suggest to you that the reason in my mind as to why it's so easy to celebrate Christmas without Christ has something to do with the providential plan of God. For if you look at it, I believe that some of the ways in which God allowed Christ to be born caused the problem as to why he's overlooked. Stay with me. When you read your Bible, you'll find that the coming of the Messiah, the birth of Christ, is probably one of the most anticipated and expected events in all of history and of humanity. There's like 325 times that it's prophesied, starting with Genesis, when God predicted that there would be one who would step on the heel of Satan and crush it by its heel. There has been this expectation that in response to human sin, God would ultimately send the Redeemer who would save us. So we've been waiting for the fulfillment of the promise of God, and there's this high hope and expectation and anticipation. One has to wonder why God would allow this great event to take place in a manger in Bethlehem. I mean, it seems that this event, this incarnation, this coming of the Lord, which is so anticipated, why would God let it go down the way he let it go down? He let it go down where so many people missed it. Jesus wasn't born in Jerusalem, in the capital of the city, in the palace, in the headquarters of a religious life. Jesus wasn't born in the temple where the Pharisees and scribes could have seen the heavens open and hear God speak. And there would have been no doubt that Jesus was the one whom they had been waiting for. How could the Messiah be born in a manger? I like movies. And it's like one of those action movies where it seems to me that God allowed Christ to come in one of those covert operations that's almost doomed to fail from the beginning. If we look at the conditions of the birth of Christ, we have an unwed teenage girl. She shows up pregnant by the Holy Spirit and gives birth to the greatest life in the history of humanity in the backside of a barn. I mean, it just seems to me that God could have done this in a more glorious and glamorous way, that God could have done this in a way where nobody missed that there was a Messiah. But allowing Christ to be born in a manger could be one of the reasons he's so easily omitted, because he comes in such a discreet way. Why be born in a manger? That's a good question. But I believe that part of the answer is that in the mystery of the manger, there is a message that God is speaking to us today. There's a miracle and a message that comes out through this mystery, and that this manger is more than just a barn and it's more than just a place for animals. But in it, we find three simple messages from God that searches our hearts today. And the very first miracle of the manger is that if you search for the Lord, you can find the Lord. Say that again. If you search for him, you will find him. Jesus is born in a manger. And the Bible says that the only people who found him were the ones who searched for him. Now, we know that Herod knows that the Christ is about to be born, but he didn't go looking for him. The ones who find him are the shepherds and the wise men who made almost a 2-year journey from the Orient to come and see him because they believed that whatever God was doing, it was worth sacrificing for. It was worth leaving some stuff behind for. It was worth giving an effort and an energy to find what God was up to. And if they searched for him, they could find him. So the message of the Lord is this: if you seek, you will find. If you try, you will obtain. If you press, you can get there. If you give it some effort, you'll see it come to pass. But if you just want to sit where you are and not search and not seek and not try and not press, then you'll never see it. But if you search for it, you can find it. Okay. So I know there are those that don't receive that because they like that convenient Christianity. They want an Amazon Prime God to just show up on their doorstep. They want a God who just shows up in their situations. They like the God that just blesses them right where they are. But here, God's saying, sometimes the blessing I have for you, I will put in your proximity. I'll put it in your vicinity. And then I desire and demand that you have a heart to search for something more than where you are right now. God will create a desire in your heart that makes you move from where you are to search for something greater, search for something holier, search for something better, search for something God has designed for your life. God says, I need you to move from where you are. You may not like it, but God has a way of creating desire that leads to searching for the Lord's will. God can desettle you and discomfort you and agitate you and aggravate you and frustrate you and irritate you and give you such discontentment and a lack of peace and remove all joy until you wake up and declare, I can't stay where I am right now. I've got to search for something better in my life. Have you ever felt that there just must be something better than this and felt like the Lord wanted you to just bust the moon so you can get out there? You've got to start searching for something. If you search for it, you will find it. Now, there is one thing about the scriptures about the wise men and the shepherds that I just need to make clear. When you search scripture, you notice things. Like I noticed that the only ones who found Jesus in the time of his birth were the shepherds. And after some study, I feel that we need to be biblically correct. Please do me a favor. Stop putting wise men in the manger. The wise men did not show up in the manger. When Jesus is born, they get a star in the east. It takes them about 2 years to get to Jerusalem. And when they get there, Matthew 2, verses 7 through 12 say they found him as a little child in a house with his mom and dad. He was not in the manger when the wise men showed up. The only ones who found him in the manger were the shepherds. You know who those shepherds was. They weren't considered the elite of Israel, the ones in the who were at the bottom of the social ladder, uneducated men who smelled because they hung out with sheep all day long.
Come on in here. Come on in here.
Circles or proper dinner tables with the educated and the elite. They were the outcast and the ostracized and got talked about. But yet these smelly, uneducated folk, when they searched for what God was doing, was able to find what God had done, which says to
them, preach it, girl, preach it.
Nothing on my resume that can keep me from discovering the will that God has as long as I search and I try and I press and I push that I can be what God wants me to be. If you search, you'll find it. If you try, you'll succeed. If you give it some good effort, it'll pay off. If you try to do better, God will help you do better. If you pray to know the Lord's will, God will reveal it to you. If you try to read your Bible more, you'll hear his voice more clearly. If you pray more, God gives you some more power. God is able to do great things in our lives. And we got to do is push and press and try and search and give it our best. If you press, you'll progress. The message of the manger is that if you search for God, if you're hungry and thirsty after God, you will be filled. When you search, you will find that one of the miracles of the manger, one of the messages that is, no matter who I am, if I try to find God's will in my hunger and my desire to be where God wants me to be, I'll find it. Amen.
Amen.
So there's another message of the manger, and is how something starts is not necessarily how it will finish. You know, people rejected Jesus as the Redeemer.
Glory!
The Messiah was not born in a palace. He was born in a manger. And those religious officials of the day who even thought they knew what the prophet said, they just could not believe that God would work through a manger. They looked at Jesus' birth certificate. They saw Mary, but they didn't see Joseph because he couldn't be listed because he wasn't a daddy. And the location was a barn in Bethlehem. And he was rejected as a Redeemer because of how it started. Now, you got to realize that these were religious folks who read scripture, knew the prophecy, and here's the danger of becoming overly religious. Their religion can fool you into believing that since you think you know what God will do, that you can also determine how he's going to do it. And they were so convinced of what God would do that they weren't open to how God could do it. They knew the Messiah would come, but they just X'd out the manger as a possible option as to how God could do what God knew needed to be done. And the danger of certain religion is that you believe your certainty is greater than God's sovereignty. God is so much God that God cannot be limited to be boxed in. God's options are infinite. And at the end of the day, no matter what anybody says, God still do whatever God chooses to do. And there's no situation God is limited. So here's part of the message of the manger is that no matter how messy it is, God can work in it. No matter how improbable it is, no matter how discredited it becomes, no matter what people think or say about it, no. God can work it in the messiest and darkest situations. God is able. God is able when there seems to be no other alternative. And when you can't imagine what God is able to do, God still has possibilities that your eyes haven't seen because God is able. In every situation, the Lord works in mangers. He works in messy places. He works in outcast situations. He works in whatever venue you find yourself in life. God has infinite possibilities of what God can do. When you think about it, what was born in a barn walked on water. What started in the manger fed 5,000. What started in a mess raised the dead and healed the sick and opened blinded eyes. What started in a manger turned water into wine. What started in a manger died on a cross and rose with all power in his hands and sits on the right hand of the throne of God making intercession for us. That's how it starts is not necessarily how it will finish. What starts in a scandal can wind up summa cum laude.
Thank you, the testimony.
What starts in pain can end in glory because God can take it from where it starts to something greater. I know there's some witnesses online that have seen the Lord take something that started small and started ugly and started in pain. But when the Lord finished what the Lord was doing, God's glory was revealed. Your life was blessed. And your testimony was the one who began a good work and you will be faithful to complete it.
Hallelujah.
Ooh, hallelujah. So the last message of the manger is that the fact that Christ is born in a manger tells me that salvation is free. If Christ had been born in the palace, I'd have issue with that because the only way to get to the palace is by invitation of the king.
And they don't let me in the palace ever.
If he'd been born in the temple, I would have a problem with that because I'd have to be a Jew, a male, and be holy to get there.
Yeah.
If he had been born in Jerusalem, I got a little problem with that because the cost of the land may have been so great I wouldn't been able to have a home there. But I'm glad he's born in the manger. Because anybody can get in the manger. You don't have to be educated to get in the manger. You don't have to be rich to get in the manger. You don't have to get your life together to get in the manger that the salvation God offers in Christ is for free.
Amen.
Preach.
Hallelujah.
Preach, preach.
This first Sunday in the Advent season is about hope. And I want to suggest to you that there is a message in the manger that will not only get you through the rest of 2020, but get you through the rest of this pandemic. And yes, it will get you through the rest of your life. I want you to meditate on this, that if you search for Jesus, you will find Jesus. And how it starts is not how it finishes. And that the salvation that the Lord offers you and that the Lord offers me in Jesus the Christ is free. what the Lord offers freely ought to be for everyone. So take that message from the manger. Know that humble beginnings turn into victory. That manger turned into a victorious story. And that even though Satan thought that he had us by having Christ born in the manger, Satan dismissed it. He dismissed the death on the cross. But because of what we know that manger was there for a reason, so that we can search for God, so that we can know that how our circumstances may not start off at the best, but they can end up great. And we know that we can take salvation for free. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
All right. Down.
Amen.
My Lord Jesus. My Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
What a word.
Phenomenal word.
Are you saved? Have you ever given your life to Jesus Christ? Confessed him as your Lord and Savior? Acknowledge that you've tried to do your life on your own, tried to be Lord of your own life, in charge of your own plans and things like that, but you failed, and that you need help from beyond yourself to sometimes get yourself out of situations that you may find yourself in, and certainly to help you find your way home when this earthly tent is destroyed. Are you saved? I want to offer Christ to you today. I want you to consider the possibility that your life can be something radically different than it is now if you accept Jesus as your personal Savior. When we are weak, He is strong. When we don't know which way to go, He knows the way we should take. When we don't know how we're going to make it from day to day, He already knows what tomorrow holds. I'm offering Christ to you today. Would you pray with me? God, our God, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. We come together humbly acknowledging, God, right now that we are sinners. We do all sorts of things that separate us from you and get ourselves into trouble. And right now we are sorry for these things that we have done or failed to do that have separated us from you, and we're asking you to save us. We're confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he died for us and that he rose for us, and that because he lives, we can face tomorrow. Thank you for washing us and cleansing us and giving us a right spirit. Help us now to follow you from this day forward. Thank you for salvation, God. Thank you for a family of Christ that makes sure that we will never walk alone. Thank you. Congratulations on your brand new life with Christ. How many of you know that the more you give to God, the more God gives to you? And what about this? That you really cannot beat God giving, no matter how you try. You ever heard that before? You ever taken God at God's word and tried God? This is our opportunity now to see if God's word is true. If we bring the full tithe into the storehouse and put God to the test, will God take care of us even during a global pandemic when the economy is down and tragedy is commonplace and people are suffering all around? Why don't we try and see if we get a testimony from our tithing? Why don't you take a moment now and get your checkbook out and get ready to write your check so that you can mail it in to Bethel AME Church, P.O. Box 2236, Fontana, California, 92334. Again, if you're mailing a check, it's to Bethel AME Church, P.O. Box 2236, Fontana, California, 92334. You also have a host of electronic giving choices. You can use Cash App at Bethel AME Fontana, or use Givelify at Bethel AME Fontana, or use PayPal at BethelAMEFontana.org and use the donate button on our website. So again, our handle at Cash App and Givelify is Bethel AME Fontana. You can also visit our website at BethelAMEFontana.org. Now listen, God wants us to test God in this one area and see if God won't open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that we don't have room enough to receive. It is true. The more we give, the more God gives to us. Thank you so much for giving back to God what God has given to you. And now, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, and the power of God rest upon you and fill you from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Let the church say,
thank you for tuning in and joining us today. Remember, we upload videos every Sunday afternoon, so don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Also, don't forget to hit that little notification bell once you hit subscribe so you can be notified every time we put up a new video. Once again, thank you for joining us for service. God bless, and see you next week.